you're going to field some questions from the committee, but if you'd like to take a few moments and tell us something about yourself that we cannot glean from your application, and I know specifically you were the only one that indicated in your application, I give you an interview, and you'll tell us more about yourself. I think those were your comments in here.
Yes.
So take only a few minutes though, but tell us something we don't know about you from this.
All right, I was born in Dade County to two career law enforcement officers. I have two children, 9 and 11 years old. My wife, we've been married for 18 years. She just had her 50th birthday, and it was an event on Saturday I think will be spoken about for a few years to come. Everybody in the community and friends and family were there. I am more than just an attorney for the past 24 years. Prior to that, I was a chemist. Prior to that, I was a lifeguard, farmer. I spent a couple of years in Kentucky on a farm. I have a very diverse background in terms of I have a pretty keen work on cars, boats, planes, trains, put things together, take them apart, and make them work again. My grandfather was a sheet metal worker. He primarily worked with wood and metal, so I have those types of hobbies. I haven't really engaged in those lately, but I still have all his tools in my garage. My other grandfather was a Ford employee for 38 years, so I have a propensity to buy Ford vehicles lately, but I grew up as a Mopar fan. I like fishing, diving. I live on Melbourne Beach. I never thought I'd live 300 feet off the ocean, growing up in a trailer park in Miami for 30 years. Been married once. Will be married to my wife for the rest of my life. It's a good marriage. Good children. They go to Gemini. And I also participate in the soccer leagues with my daughter. We travel. And my son is in baseball. Still learning how to hit the pitches coming to him, but he can throw and catch and run pretty well.
Thank you. That's it. Dan, I'm going to start with you, please.
All right. Yes, sir. Are there any judicial practices that you would emulate if you were appointed to the bench?
I was asked that before, and my answer would be consistent with that, John Harris. John Harris is one that I really appreciated and respected when I was in front of him for about 3 years. Prior to that, J. Preston Silvernail. And those are the two that I really follow, respect, probably.
It's a slightly different question, though, than judges whom you have respect.
Yes.
The practice, the process in the court, the approach to cases.
Yes.
I'm asking more about procedure.
Well, the same people. I like the way that John Harrison and Silvernail would embrace and respect the people before them. We have, and this is in criminal court, in a very tolerant and even-keeled demeanor. There's no drama other than the orders and the final result from the clients, but they would not engage in the fray. They would stay alone.
Donna?
It's so nice to see you again. Thank you for your persistence. And I won't ask you about your varied background. I don't think I did that last time, but of course, very interesting. I enjoy reading it. If you could tell us, what is your single greatest accomplishment that you think demonstrates your ability for this position?
I would say being with the public defenders and staying with that job, it's a very trying job. It's fast-paced. You hit the ground running at 8 o'clock in the morning. You don't stop until court is over, and you still don't stop after that. Consistency is paramount. I mean, you have to be consistent and even-keeled, and I think the public defender's office has taught me that. I was in private practice prior to that, but I try to maintain that. My mother is my bedrock in that. She was the cornerstone and just solid and consistent. She was a law enforcement officer for 34 years. I've learned that. They basically grew up in a single parent household. And I think that carries through to me and carries through to my education, my children, and same by my wife.
Hi again. Good to see you. I know you were right out of law school in 1995, but you were in private practice for 5 years, which is not chump change. And who is the other Dwyer, and what type of practice, what did you do?
That's Robert Dwyer, my father. He graduated from St. Thomas University prior to me, and we had the good fortune of having a family that let us use their office building and their office space as long as I handled some of their family matters. He essentially handled the criminal cases in the firm, and I was handling the civil real estate and the estate planning for 5 years, and that was down on 8th Street, a guy named Joe in Miami, and an Osterley family, who Claire Osterley was on the commission for Dade County, and Steve Clark, the mayor's right-hand person. They're the family that gave us the office space, but our practice was varied. It was diverse, it was small, and...
Why'd you leave to go to
My mother had retired up here in Melbourne Beach. She knew the chaos, the overcrowding of Dade County, and complaints of traffic and everything. And she said, one day I have an interview with you, with Bud Stack. He needs you up here tomorrow. And so I got in the car, came up, Bud Stack. I don't know if you know Charles Rickman Stack. He has had a civil practice here in Melbourne. He interviewed me, hired me, and allowed me for the next 6 months to close my practice down in Miami, which also included federal court, so I had to wrap up some things. And Bud Stack's brother, older brother, John Stack, was the road sergeant with my father, so I may have had a little foot in the door in that respect.
Phil?
Good seeing you again. Thank you for applying. If you had one quality over all other qualities that you have, what is that quality that you feel would make you an excellent little circuit court judge?
Let's say perception, perspicacity, perception, being able to see people, look them in the eye, read what is presented to me. I have to tell you, the cell phone number I gave you, it's not my cell phone number. I have not had a cell phone for 8 years. And I think, and I'm not casting dispersion, but I think we've lost a lot of that looking in the eye of people. Because the eyes are the window of the soul. You can tell. I will never do a deposition by telephone. I have to be across from the person. I have to see what they're doing, whether they're fidgeting, whether they're looking down. And when we lose eye contact, when we lose that perception, I think we're selling ourselves short. I think we're missing a lot. We're not looking around. We're not embracing the environment around us. We're not looking at the person that we're addressing or being concerned, trying to engage with.
Yeah.
Yes. What type of temperament do you think a judge should have?
I think it should have a consistent, even keel. And I said before, don't get into the fray. You have to be a neutral person. You have to be the referee on the field without any picking any sides, any political sides, any preferences, or whether a person is good. You have to just maintain that consistency. If an old adage is, so when you get upset, count to 10, I thought for years. That's, come on. There's a lot to say. You don't have to count to 10. Just take a breath. Sit back, reflect a little bit, introspect, think about what you're going to say, think about what you're going to do, and don't act rashly or quickly. As an example, it takes me about 6 months to buy a vehicle. I have to go out, test drive them, look them over. I don't go onto a lot and buy it immediately. I'm just not that compulsive type of person.
David?
Morning. Looking at your background and hearing about your background, since 2002, you've done exclusively criminal defense work, correct?
Yes.
So before that, you were at Pine Stakes for 2 years, and your application says you were doing, playing as personal injury work.
Yes.
And then you talked a little bit before about 5 years before that, you were at Dwyer and Dwyer. You said your dad mostly did criminal defense.
Correct.
And according to this, you were doing tenancy, real estate, closings, and some estate probate work.
Yes.
So my question is, I'm trying to get a better, more full picture of what your experience was over those 7 years in non-criminal stuff. At the PI firm, for example, were you litigating cases, or were you doing intake, pre-suit work? At Dwyer and Dwyer, were you litigating those tenancy real estate matters, or is that more transactional stuff?
The first 5 years at Dwyer and Dwyer was mostly transactional in the office, dealing with people on that. I had very few court trials or hearings, and a lot of it was spent in the ex parte probate division up in Dade County. With High Stack, the only litigation I was involved in was a wrongful death action from Vince Torpy, and right after jury selection it settled, but it went to mediation. I've been in many mediations with Bud Stack and with the other attorneys associated with that firm, Mike Cruanis. So not a lot of court time as a civil attorney, but that's one of the motivating factors to go with the PD's office at the time. It was not a default choice. I wanted to be in court as much as possible. The interactions, not only with court personnel, the deputies, the clerks, but with the clients. And my father taught me at that time, he's passed now. He says, the people, they're the real people that you deal with. Those are the people that you deal with every day, the homeless, the ones that are having troubles, court cases, having problems. Those are the ones you need to really help. And you need to lift them up, give them some hope, because my thought and philosophy is a society or a team or anything is only as strong as its weakest link. So we need to find and not really identify them as the weakest link, but assist them with their court cases, try to get them educated, try to give them some hope, some inspiration, some self-esteem.
Thank you. Andrew.
Sir, and I apologize because Donna had indicated that you probably talked about this in the past, and I'm sorry to rehash. In response to question 15, your application packet, you talked about your work as a scientist and a chemist, and you said it has enhanced your research abilities. Could you expound further upon that?
Yes. When I was working as research and development for Sharon Plow, so sometimes they would throw a product or a chemical on the table and say, how can you use this, or what does this clinical study show us? And you have to make references to the USP, the United States Pharmacopoeia, National Formulary, Clark's Dictionary for Analysis, and I was basically an analytical chemist. I was not a physical chemist where I would put the products together. I would test the products. I would send them out to clinical research facilities. We'd get the samples back and test serum levels, see if the drug was effective, if it was getting into the body or not. And I was, so how does that help me as an analyst? I refer to reference materials all the time. Westlaw is my best friend right now, the statutes. So I am able to go through technical and legal documents, and I can get to the part I need. I can thumb through a car repair manual, 150 pages long, and I can get to where I need to be very quickly. So I think that analytical research helped me zero in and focus on things that I need to focus on.
Very good response.
I just got a couple questions, Mike. I have to tell you, and this is not the first time I've read your application, we've been before the committee a few times. You know, your application is one of the most interesting ones I read, but you're kind of an enigma rather than a riddle to me. I'll tell you what I mean by that. You have a vast experience in life, from the analytical chemist to all the other jobs you've done. You have a net worth which is impressive compared to the other applications this committee is looking at, so you obviously are not doing the work for the money right now in the public defender's office. So I'm trying to figure out why is Michael Dwyer a public defender you said it takes you, you know, 6 months to buy a car. Are you one of those people that just likes to help out the downtrodden, likes to think about things and analyze things? And why do you have a PD's office, having come from private practice? I mean, usually people come out of school, they go to the PD's office, and they get a little bit of courtroom experience, and they go off and they do their thing. And you're kind of working backwards here. Yeah.
Well, I don't see it looking backwards. Again, I don't want to go to a previous statement about the weakest link. Try to help people. And it's not all about public service, but a large part of my life has been public service. My parents, 34 years in the police department, Metro Dade Police Department, 26 years with the Metro Dade Police Department. And all the people I associated with prior to going to college were engaged in public service. My wife is engaged in public service. She's City of Vero Beach Recreation Tennis Supervisor, and she loves it. It's not the greatest paying job. It's not the highest level job. But the people she associates with enriches her life, and the people I associate with enrich my life so much. When I look at it as a challenge also, and I'm sure attorneys have dealt with criminal defense clients. When you get a client who's not really accepting or liking the advice you're giving, and it hit just personal and nasty, that's not a time where I turn my back. That's a time when I sit back and I listen to them. I try to listen to what they have to say. And I try to absorb what they're saying. And I try to maybe change the conversation a little bit. And how can I help you? How can I make it better? How can I reassure you? Some people don't like you putting your hand on their shoulder, but standing up in court and standing between them and the state attorney's office, and when they finally see, after the weeks and the months of preparation, how you're going full gorilla and defending them with everything you can, that enriches my life. This application process, if you try and you fail, it's better than not trying at all. And that's something that that's a mantra I give to my children. You throw your hat in the ring, you make yourself available. And if it happens, good for you. And if you succeed, even better. But don't stop trying. So I don't stop trying for any of my clients. And I've tried the private practice before. I liked it, but I really enjoy the interactions that I have with public defender's offices. It's such a diverse from judges, doctors, expert witnesses, state attorneys, clerks, the deputies. I know most of the deputies in this county just from my interactions in the courtroom.
Thank you, Michael. We appreciate it.
Yes.
Thank you. Yeah, Brad. Anyone have any follow-up questions?
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.